And good morning. It's Wednesday the 8th of February. Yeah, not January. The 8th of February 2017. Welcome to today's United Kingdom Talk, boys and girls. I had a few little issues with that new webcam, actually. It kept jumping around. I don't know what the cause of that was. But it seems if I, like, reduce the colour a bit, this is on the live stream, not on the recording. If I reduce the colour a bit, it seems not to jump anymore. So I'm trying to work out that what's going wrong there. But we're here anyway. That's all that matters. We must say a big hello this morning to JoAnna. Now, JoAnna has only recently joined the programme a few weeks ago. And she's ended up in hospital. I'm not quite sure what's wrong, but she's been kept in for a couple of days now. It gets worse. It gets worse, right? Even worse than... And we must say hello to all the nurses that have now started watching the programme as well. Daily, apparently. They wake up poor JoAnna, you know, in bed. Come on, wake up, JoAnna, the show's here. And they sit there watching it. And so we must say hello to the nurses and, I don't know, the doctors as well, maybe, watching it as well, in a hospital somewhere in the United States of America. But it gets worse. The item that I sent her through the post was apparently opened by customs and not put back together properly and has arrived broken. God's sake, man. I mean, it's just hopeless, isn't it? So, well, I'll have to send another one, I think. I'll send another one. We'll try once more, JoAnna, OK? I'll try again, but you will have to send me your address again, or some sort of postal address, maybe to the hospital, I don't know, and I'll get another one in the post to you as well. All right, darling, don't worry about that. Let's say hello to some early risers this morning. I say early risers, you know, people that are with us right at the beginning of the show today. Wendy's there. Good morning, Wendy. Gustav says, don't forget to twiddle your knobs so we can hear the caller. Done. I have now twiddled the button to make sure you can hear the people that were calling in, because I keep forgetting to. It's literally just pushing a button. That's all it is. Thank you, Gustav. Good morning to Kevin Webster. Danny Davis is there. Good morning, Danny. good morning, Warren in Tenerife. My friend lives in Tenerife. I don't know if you know him. He does a cabaret show, The Boy George Experience, also known as Mandy Gap. Do you know Keith George? Very, very good at what he does. He does a lot of work in the hotels over there in Tenerife and lives there as well. He always makes me quite jealous, you know, when he rings around sort of, we have FaceTime calls around sort of December, January, February. And there he is sitting on the balcony while I'm shivering, you know, huddled up like my cat does to a radiator. Morning, Warren. good morning to Rod Brown. John Child is there. Hello, John. I had your item for you on Monday, but don't worry, it's still in the car. All right, John. Good morning to Tim Pardington, karaoke man. Good morning, Tim. Nice to see you this morning. And that's it. I think that's it for now, is it? Hang on. We don't like to miss anyone out. Tim says, I got a sample of Belvita biscuits from Wimbledon Station this morning. Oh, was that for your breakfast? Oh, no, Tim. I never understand that. How you can have... And they are advertised as the breakfast biscuit. So you have one biscuit and that's breakfast. No. No, I mean, I'd have to have at least half a packet of chocolate biscuits for breakfast if I was having biscuits. Now, talking to chocolate, Tim, oh, come on, Tim, get up a bit earlier and have a proper breakfast. It's not good for you, apparently, especially if you're losing weight. It's supposed to be very bad to miss breakfast first time in the morning. Did you know that? Yes, it's true. Now, look, Adam the plumber, I think he's better. I haven't heard from him. He was supposed to turn up on Monday. But I haven't heard from him. I hope his back's all right. Has given me, because he knows we're all trying to lose a bit of weight now, especially me, especially after my birthday. 3 birthday cakes I received this year. How marvellous is that? One on my birthday, which my best mate Ron brought me round. There was one Sunday night that we had Kelly Kim and Laura and Sky, who come along to the karaoke. We do a once a month karaoke in Sydenham now. They bought me one, and it was like a chocolate cake and lots of little fairy cake type things around it with tops and bits of jam, and I had that. And then Monday night, I had this great big chocolate cake with chocolate buttons on it and all that. And that was from Central Station. I think it was Johnny Key and Non-Irish Mary from Ireland who provided that. And that was all very nice. But not only that, bars of chocolate were bought in, boxes of chocolate. And I've had to ask people to stop bringing in me and chocolate. Because nice people, and they are nice to do it, they keep bringing me in bars of chocolate. And they're not the small ones. Ray Reynolds, he started bringing in these, they're as big as that. You know those great big massive galaxy ones? And I do not have willpower when it comes to biscuits, chocolate or crisps. So I open that big thing like that, and then it's gone. Gone straight away. So Adam the plumber has bought me in this, because Adam does Slimming World. And he's lost half a stone. I think it was half a stone in 2 weeks. Yes, half a stone. What's that the Americans want to know? I think it's about £7. Is it 14 stone? If it's 14 pounds and a stone? I think it's about £7 he's lost in 2 weeks. So he's given me these. Slimming World chocolate. Which I am supposed to try while I'm talking to you. Now, the thing is, I would have done it today, but I haven't bought myself up a cup of tea or a drink. And I've got a feeling if I put a bit of chocolate in my mouth, as well as me trying not to sniff in front of you and go all the time, it's going to make it even worse. So I will do that. Devour me double choc crisp chocolate. Oh, is it milk chocolate? Does it say? Hold on a minute. Well, I can't see that. Where's my glasses? One minute. A seriously chocolatey cereal bar with raisins sprinkled with dark chocolate chunks dipped and drizzled in smooth milk chocolate. You want some, don't you? None for you. All for me, thank you. None for you at all. And he also gave me this one, similar thing, dark choc mint. Now, I've got to tell you, Adam, not keen on choc mint. So I probably won't have those. I'll put those back in the car and bring them back to you. Now, my mate Ron likes these, so I will have to hide these from him because he's got a habit of going in the cupboards whenever he gets here, you know, and starts searching for things to eat. I would never, ever do that in his house. Never in a million years. Except last night where I discovered last night a hidden packet of McVitie's milk chocolate digestive biscuits in his cupboard. Hidden. They were hidden behind the tins. Yes. I think they belonged to his other half, Andy, to be honest. Because we had a nice night last night. Very nice indeed. It was my birthday day yesterday, which was actually 2 days after my birthday. What me and my mate do now is when it comes around to birthday times, we have, so for example, yesterday was Chris's day. Whereas kind of for the whole day, he has to do basically what I tell him to do. You know, oh no, no funny business like that. That was 25 years ago, dear. Oh no. Don't fancy anything like that, dear. Good God, no, thank you very much. No, nothing like that. I know what you're thinking. Stop it now. Stop, this is a family programme. I've told you time and time again, a family-based programme, OK? You'll be able to call in a minute. We will be opening phone lines in a moment, boys and girls. I have to tell you this story. So yesterday, in the past, what we've done is gone down either to London or to Biscester, or was it Biscester, Outlet Village, where you've got all the designer clothes shops at a discount. And we've spent a day down there, had a bit of lunch and spent vast, you know, a lot of money actually down there. Not just from him, but for me as well, you know. He buys a gift and then I start buying loads of other stuff down there. So, I mean, it's deadly going down there. If you don't want to spend money, don't go to Bicester Village because you'll go there for one item and then you'll come back with endless carrier bags full of stuff. You know, all good quality stuff, mind, but not necessarily stuff that you would have gone to buy in the first place. But yesterday, I'd already decided what I wanted to do and I wanted to buy a new iPhone. OK, not a brand new one. I don't really like going for the one that's bang up to date because that's like, you know, £250, £300 dearer than the next one down. That's always going to be the... And there's never a special offer on an iPhone. Never. I don't remember ever seeing a sale where it says an iPhone's today will be £150 off. No. Never going to happen because people want to buy them anyway, so they don't need to do that. You know, I am a little bit tight. I'm a bit tight. I mean, it took me years and years to start putting my eating on here. You know, I used to have coats on and jumpers and things like that all the time. instead of putting the heat in. Now, I get cold, I just flick a button, and immediately it bursts out. The cat's always pleased when I put the heating on. Oh, she's over the moon. She carts going, meow, meow, all round my legs. Oh, thank you so much for putting the heating on. And when the heating's not on, and she's a bit cold, do you know what she does? This is no word of a lie. There's a little stall next to one of the radiators in the utility room. And if she sees me, she jumps on the stall and stares at the radiator like that. And she just stares at the radiator, hoping, trying to will it to come on. So I flick the button and I put it on for her. Anyway, so yesterday I decided to buy an iPhone and we walked into the, we walked past the ghastly people in Reading. Please don't ever go to, what a dump that is, Reading. I mean, and it's a shame. It's not the shops. It's not the shops. They have a couple of wonderful shopping places there. There's a John Lewis. There's a John Lewis. There is the Oracle Shopping Centre. It's the people walking around. You don't feel safe. There's one bloke there, set up in the middle, doing, what's it called? Rainbow hair braiding. Rainbow, and you know, random people just go and say, oh, can you do my hair? And he starts putting bits of coloured blooming wool or something in their hair. What's all that about? Rainbow hair. There's a couple of, you know, and I this is not a, you know, I don't joke about this sort of thing, but there's a couple of beggars walking around. Now there's beggars and there's beggars. This one was clearly comatose. His eyes were rolling back in his head. He's probably just jacked up and injected himself somewhere. He's wandering around with his hand out like, you know, hoping for some more money for a latest injection. What do they call it? And it hit, a latest hit of blooming drugs into his arm. You got the chuggers running around. Oh, don't you hate those? Oh, hello, hello. Oh, I'm collecting money for some. Go away. I don't want to see you. Get lost. Don't want to see you. Chuggers running around. It's a horrible place, Reading. It really is. And it didn't seem to be like that when I first moved there. Dreadful, ghastly people there. Anyway, so we rushed through all these people. And Ronnie's got a disabled badge in his car because of his back. So, and you park in this disabled bit, but he doesn't look disabled, if you see. He's one of those people that don't look disabled. And there's a lot of people who are disabled. Maybe they've got some sort of terrible blood disease or something like that, you know. And if you don't look disabled, the looks you get from people as you pull up and get out your car, oh, horrendous. Now, I have, funnily enough, I'm not disabled, really. And I do have a trouble getting in and out of his car. He's got a low-level BMW, right? And honestly, yes, they are very expensive cars and they are premium cars. I'm just not comfortable in this damn thing. I'm really not. And I have the most incredible trouble getting in and out of it now. It might be because I've got little legs. And I put my legs out the door and they're like swinging, they're not touching the floor, and I've got a hold, and I'm trying to get out like that. It's horrendous getting out of the car. So when I get out of it, it looks like I'm the one who's disabled, honestly. And then you get out and you can't quite straighten up, can you? Oh god, I'm so uncomfortable with that car. It really is. But that's what he wants and that's what he likes. So, you know, that's up to him. His boyfriend also, he's got a BMW as well. And it's just the same. Just as uncomfortable. I don't know why that is. Now, when I had a low-level car, a Yaris, I've got a Toyota now, so you kind of go up into that. I didn't have the same trouble getting in and out of it. I don't know if it was because I was in the driver's seat. But anyway, so we get out of this car, you know, as always, people are giving you dirty looks. So why are they parking there, you know, right next to the shops in the disabled place? And all three disabled places were there yesterday. So we got in there. So we come out of there, rushed through the ghastly people of Reading going about their shopping. And we went into the shopping centre. And I was so surprised. Yesterday, we intended to have a milkshake to start with from Ed's Diner. Oh, just previously to that, we'd been out today. And he said, I'll take you out to dinner in Reading. I said, do you know what I fancy today? Beans and chips. He said, well, we can go out to dinner. It doesn't have to be beans and chips. I said, no, I just fancy beans and chips. I tell you what, let's go to the chip shop in Bracknell. So we went to the chip shop in Bracknell, bought some chips back here, and I did baked beans and chips. That's what I wanted. I'm not a posh person. I can't be doing with all these fancy restaurants and mucking about. You know, and those restaurants where you get the great big plate and this tiny little thing in the middle of the plate. And that's your dinner. 200 quid, please. No, thank you. I want to feel full up when I've had something to eat, don't you? Dear me. So we had that. Come to Reading. So we go, Ed's Diner. And we got to it and it's closed again. Now, it was closed when we went a couple of weeks ago. When I went to, where did we go a couple of weeks ago? Can't remember. Oh, wait, that was John Lewis. That was a John Lewis visit as well. But this time I went up to it and I read the sign. They're in administration. Ed's Diner in administration. I thought, you must be joking. So that's not just that shop. Presumably that's all of them. I should have looked that up actually before I started chatting to you today. That's all of the Ed's. Have you ever been in one? They're lovely. Well, they used to be lovely. You may remember about 6-9 months ago, we went in there and I was a regular customer. And I say regular customer, you know, 3 or 4 times a year we used to go to Ed's Diner. Either the one in Soho, which is kind of in the middle of two roads, or the one in Reading, which is not too far from me at all. And I would always have a veggie burger and chips. And then the last time we went, this food came out and it had got smaller. Because everything's shrinking, isn't it? Except my stomach. You know, it's not shrinking. Everything is shrinking. And out came the burger and the chips. And I said, what's gone wrong with those chips? I said to Ronnie while I was sitting, what's wrong with these chips? He said, what do you mean? He said, they're not the same as they used to be. And I said, after the meal, we called this waiter over, who was ever so camp. Can I help you? You know, can I help you? You know, people don't really know I'm gay unless I tell them, you know, I'm butch. Butch. You know, I come across as like a, you know, an England rugby player or someone like that, as you can tell from yourself, as you can tell from watching this worldwide phenomenon known as United Kingdom Talk. So I remember him coming over and I said, something's changed. He said, what's changed? He said, yes. He said, they've changed the burgers and the chips. I said, well, what's different about the chips? He said, they're now about an inch and a half shorter. And I'm like, why did they do that? Oh, customers said they preferred that. What a load of old rubbish that is. No one said they prefer. How would you say you prefer shorter chips? Don't lie to me, sunshine. What a load of old rubbish. And I said to Ronnie then, and then the milkshakes came out, and the milkshakes were exactly the same. The milkshakes are to die for in Ed's Diner. There's something about them that they're really, really nice. So so we had that and finish off. And I remember then saying to him in the car, I said, well, it's the last time I go in there. Next time we go in there, we'll just have the milkshake and not the food. Because they changed it. They changed it. Well, lo and behold, 6 to 9 months down the line, it's closed. Not just that one, but all of them. Ed's Diner has gone into administration. And I'm really shocked at that. Really quite shocked. So no milkshake. Or so we thought. Then I remembered that we'd bought milkshakes in the Oracle shopping centre before, which is in Reading, okay? So we're walking down there and I walked past this place and I think it was a green colour, I can't remember. Anyway, there I saw, milkshakes, you know, cakes, large biscuits, what are those American large biscuits called? Cookies, all sorts of, and ice creams down there. And so I went up to this, and there was two women in there. One youngish, about 25, big girl she was, and another one older, and they're doing things in the back. Excuse me, and she's come out, face like thunder. This young one, yes? I said, do you do milkshakes, please? Oh, no, we don't do milkshakes. I said, what do you mean you don't do milkshakes? We don't do milkshakes. Oh, well, what's that say up there? And she said, well, I said, it says milkshakes up there. You don't do those? Oh, I said, well, don't bother, love. And then her friend, and then the old one turned around. And I said to Ronnie, bloody hell, the attitude of her. How do they sell anything? You know, and I'm not talking to her like I'm talking. I'm quite friendly when I'm out. Honestly, I am. Hello, love. Can I have a milkshake? Oh, we don't do them. What do you mean you don't do them? Well, we don't do milkshakes. We just do ice cream. What's that say up there then? Milkshakes. stupid. How do these people sell anything when they have bad customer service? That's why John Lewis does so well. Fantastic service in there. And not just John Lewis. I'm just coming to this bit. Just coming to this bit. We then went into Apple. Apple in Reading, where I have been in there four times over the last year or so, thinking about buying a new iPhone. It takes me forever to part with money, dear. It really does. Unless it involves my niece, nephews, great nieces or great nephews, I can't part with the money. Or my sister. I don't mind buying them stuff. When it comes to me, I'm so tight, it's unbelievable. I can't part with the money. I've been in John Lewis four times and sat in an electric armchair thinking about it. In this armchair. They think I'm mad. Oh, hello again, sir. Come to try the armchair again. So we went in the Apple shop. Approached by this... and Ron is terrible, he is. He's gone straight up to the shop assistant and said, he wants to buy a new iPhone today. Can we have a nice looking boy to do it for as a salesman? He's dreadful, dreadful. At which point they brought a lovely young girl over. And she looked like... there's a certain look that some gay people have. And she certainly looked gay. So she came over. Hello there. And she had tattoos. I said, oh, you look like one of us. And she started laughing. She said, yes. And she was so nice. I cannot give this girl enough compliments. And I said, I want to buy an iPhone SE, please, today. I've got another one to trade in here. This is an iPhone 5S. Now, I have to tell you, the iPhone SE is the one in between the 6 and the 7. It's not part of the 5 family. It's the same size as my iPhone 5. The iPhone 6 is, I think both of them are a bit bigger. There's a 6 and a 6 Plus. And certainly, Ronnie's got the 6 Plus, he hasn't. He's got the 7 now. He's got the 7 Plus, or whatever is the large 7 one. And it would be fantastic while I'm recording my shows. Incidentally, if you're watching a recording of this show, then this is the first one done on the new phone, okay? On the new iPhone. And the big one would be fantastic to do my shows with, but in reality, when it rings and you're out some and you're picking up this great big thing, I just think it's a bit too much to hold on to. He's got one, but I didn't want that. I won't buy a 7. Because they are way, way overpriced when they first come out. You know, if you want the new technology, yeah, it's there, but you've got to pay for it. So I thought I'll go for the one between the six, which is the next one down. So 7, SE, 6, 5S, and that's how it goes. So I've got this one. So she's looked it up on her little device. No one's walking around with pens and clipboards in there, dear. Oh, no, dear. It's all touch, 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 like that. And... Oh, yeah, well, so we got the... I can have a silver one, please. Silver at 64 gigs, please. 64, yep, that's it. Because it only goes up to 64. Now, my 5S was a 64. Some of you probably have much more memory on yours. Maybe 128. I believe there's one that's 256 now. Not sure on that one. But I never use it all up. What happens is that I record my stuff on it. I don't have much music on the phone. Maybe 20 tunes, tops, 20 songs on there. And that wouldn't be songs like what you've got on your iPhone. No, it's bits of music. Bits of music that I've collected from television and radio jingles over the year. How sad is that? Ronnie says that's why I've not got a boyfriend. Because when I come into the car, I start putting on radio jingles and things like that. Da-da-da-da-da! And that... An old television adverts. One of my favourites is Safeway's. Safeway, everything you want from a store and a little bit more from the 1970s. I love all that. So I haven't got much music on there. All I carry on there really is photos, some apps, and the videos. And when I've recorded a video, like some of you watching it live now, some of you watching a recording. Once it's recorded and sent up to Facebook and YouTube, that's it. I delete it. So I never don't really need anything more than 64 gig, at least not at the moment. So I've ordered this. And she's tap, tap, tapping away. I said, and I want to hand this one in as well, please. And they'd already told me this one would be worth, the old phone would be worth between £75 and £100. which is a, you know, it's a fair mark off. Brand new, the new phone, I think, was about 420. So you get a bit of money off that. I thought, yeah. Ronnie and his boyfriend, they gave me more than half towards the new phone. So I was that was really nice. And so I gave her the phone and we're chatting away to her. She's ever so nice and chatty, this girl. Her name was Cam. Now, I think it's K-A-M or C-A-M. Cam, if you ever go into the Reading Apple shop, ask for her. She really was very, very nice. And she knew all about everything. And nothing was too much trouble for her. So she's taken out the phone from me. She said, well, yeah. She said, that looks in pretty good condition. I reckon we can give you £90 for that. Wow. £90. So very quickly, that phone that was 420, 320, 220, £200 for my mates, 220, 120, 130. It's only cost me 130 quid. Brand new phone. Handed in the old one, got £200 from my mates. Oh, I'm over the moon, dear. Over the moon. Brand new iPhone, £120. So there we go. Now, so they then take us. So she gets all this. She goes and gets the little phone in a brand new box and everything. Typing thing. I'm having to put in my name and address on this thing, and things like that. And we'll type it away. Chat in a while. And I looked at her, and there's something. And you know, I'm a vegetarian, yeah. And it's a bit like some. Often you can tell people who are gay or not just as they walk. Oh, that one's gay. Just know. I seem to have the same thing with vegetarians now. I said. This is a really random question. You're vegetarian, aren't you? She said, yeah, how do you know? I said, I don't know. I just know that straight away. I said, why is that? I said, is it animal cruelty? She said, yeah, that's right. I said, do you watch the YouTube video? She said, yeah. I said, yeah, that's what done it for me. I mean, I've been a vegetarian about 4 years now. It was the animal cruelty videos and all that business. So we're chatting about that while she's doing her work, tap, away. And after our conversations, we get taken over to another table. And there's a lad there, and he's nice, lovely boy, but he's got one of those stupid buns on his head. What do they look like? For God's sake, you know, like let me use this blue piece of roll as an example here, right? So he's got this blue thing on his head like that, right? He's got one of those blue buns on his head. I'm sorry, I haven't done any of your messages, yeah? I'll come back to your messages in a minute, gang. All right? So he's got this blue bun on his head. And he is nice enough. So she's explaining what's happening and all that. So they've decided. So what they want to do now is transfer everything from my old phone to the new phone. I haven't got to lift a finger. They do it all there as part of the deal. They do it all there and then. So she's typing in some numbers to this. I have to put in my PIN code a few times. I've swapped the SIM over. And then things start happening. And one phone's going to the other. And I said, oh, those tripods over there. Now, when I do my karaoke nights, okay, as you well know, we stream the entire night on the internet, on Facebook One Colour. We do. And the tripod I've got is a bit broken, okay? But I cannot find one. And I spotted three tripods over there. Well, that wasn't too trouble for her. She's gone straight over, got all three down, stuck, because there's nothing on display. And that's the only thing in Apple. There's nothing on display. It's all in the boxes. You know, you haven't got an example, whereas you're going to John Lewis and there'd be like things out, wouldn't there? So you'd have a tripod set up somewhere like that and what have you. No, it's all in the boxes. She's got the boxes down. She's opening the boxes. And I thought, and the clamp that holds the iPhone was very good. It's like that, you know, you adjust it. I thought, that's good. Well, the first tripod looked really good. The legs at the bottom were plastic, but they looked quite strong. The only thing is it really wasn't weighted at all. And you'd touch it and the thing would bounce around. And I thought, oh, that's no good. The next one was much better. That was much heavier and it was down like that. But there was no stick, you know, so you couldn't, you know, it was very low. So that would be no good for me. And the third one, which was also, I rejected that straight away until she got it down. It was like the legs were like little knobble things. And it was like loads of little knobble things. And you would bend them. You would bend them around like that and you could hold on to somewhere like that. But again, there was no stick, so you didn't have the height. So she got all the... Oh, I did feel guilty, dear. She got all these things down from the shelves and I didn't buy anything extra. I did feel guilty. So I thanked her. I said, I'm ever so sorry. I can't find anything. None of these are really suitable for what one. So I still didn't manage to get one of those. Anyway, so time went on. And eventually, everything was moved from that phone to that phone. And she said, some of the apps won't work until you get back into a Wi-Fi area. And then they will update. They will update themselves as soon as you get into your Wi-Fi at home. And then everything will start working. How fantastic is that? So we were in there. We must have been in there an hour and a quarter, an hour and a half, something like that. And then we came out of there and it was all done. So that was very nice. We then went to another milkshake place. So actually top marks for Apple. Fantastic service in there. Absolutely fantastic service in there. I cannot say enough about how well that girl treated us in there. Absolutely fantastic. Highly recommended. And as I say, her name is Cam. Might be C-A-M, K-M. I don't know how she spells it. Cam, beautiful young girl, about 22 years old. And she works in the Apple in Reading. Fantastic service. After that, we came out there and we found another little milkshake place. So I sat down. It's like some seats in the middle of the shopping centre, you know, where generally, you know, not very nice people sit there. They all sit there, you know. They sit there with another, but, you know, with their packed lunches. These are the people that are too tight to go into Burger King or McDonald's. They bring out a packed lunch and they sit, and they sit there in the middle, stuffing their faces while other people are going, you know, sitting there all on their phones. And they've got one of those new iPhone, not just iPhone, mobile phone charging stations where it's like a box on the wall with lights in it, and there's about six. Now we've got one of these in a pub in where I work in the Two Brewers on Thursday nights. We've got one of these in a pub, and what you do, although it wasn't the same as the pub one, in this shopping centre, there's about six drawers, and you open a doors with like drawers with doors, and you open the door. And then you plug your phone in, you close the door, turn the key, take the key out, and off you go. And you get free 30 minutes to charge your phone, which is quite a good idea. And I'm looking at this thing, and they're all on keys. They're keys. And I thought to myself, I wonder how many of those keys get lost or nicked. Because you know what people are like. They're not bothered. Of course, you have to put the key back in to get your phone out. But, you know, I don't suppose there's anything to stop you then closing the drawer, turning the key and taking the key home with you. I wonder how many of those keys get lost. An interesting thought for you. Now, the one in our pub in the Two Brewers in Clapham, where I work on Sundays doing some Thursdays doing some DJing. The one in there, you use your credit card. So you put your credit card in a slot. I've told you this before. Put credit card in a slot like that. And then a door opens. Or I think a light comes on and you open the door yourself. You put your phone in, plug it in, close the door, put your credit card in again or something like that. Can't remember now. No, you've already done that, haven't you? Close the door and then you wander off. And your credit card is the key. And when you come back, you know, half hour later, you put your credit card back in the slot, pull it out, the door swings open, and you take your phone out and off you go. That's it. Which is a much better idea. I don't know how many of those keys that the places get lost like that. Let's just go. We've got a phone call coming in here. Who's on the line, please?
Hello, it's the staff of Blakey.
Hello, Blakey. How are you?
How you doing? You all right?
All right. Yes, thank you. What are you calling in about?
I had no idea what I'm calling about. I just wanted to call to see if I could actually get through.
Of course you can get through. This is not an amateur setup, dear. This is a proper radio and television broadcast. Eh?
I want to ask you a couple of questions, then.
Ask away.
Right, here we go.
Have you got music on in the background there, dear?
Yeah, I had a bit of M People. It cheers my
M People.
A for the hero.
I like M People.
It makes me feel, it sort of like gives me hope. Like, I listen to, like, growing up and I listen to M People. I never liked M People.
Oh, One Night in Heaven is my favourite song by them. One Night in Heaven is my favourite song by them. It's a most enjoyable. One Night in Heaven, One Night in Heaven. Do you like that one?
Yeah, for you.
Did you hear any of that at all?
Say again?
Did you hear anything that I just said to you, or are you just rabbiting on, dear?
I'm rabbiting as usual. So glad, nice to hear your voice again. Do you do any... You don't do... Why has Graham got the gig in London Bridge on a Monday night? I thought that would be for you. Like, what happened?
Oh, that was about a year and a half ago now. Maybe is it? I would say about a year and a half ago. They rung me up and I was already working somewhere on a Monday. And I'm quite a loyal person. If someone gives me a job, I don't go anywhere else, generally. For more money. Once you've given me a job, I tend to stick with you until it runs its course or something awful happens. You know, you might get a different manager in who you don't like or something like that. So, yes, it was offered to me. But I couldn't take it, so I had a think, and I thought Graham would be the best person to do it.
Oh, it was
I really did. So I rang him.
Great.
I gather they'd already been in contact, or he'd already been in contact with him. So I recommended him, and they said to me, "Oh, he's already been in contact." I said, "Well, okay then." I said, "I would give the job to him. I thought he'd be the best person for that particular face."
If he could have done karaoke 7 nights a week in Blue Eyed Maid, like that's good enough for me. Like that's like, yeah, you can get the job done. He's
yes,
good.
Yes.
You know, you've all got your different qualities, I suppose. Me personally, I prefer it when you do it because I could have a laugh and a joke, you know. But
it's all different. It's all people like different people, but yeah, and he's made a success of it. So excellent. You know, I had 5 wonderful years there. And the other thing is, Blakey, you know, if you go back to somewhere, you don't pick up where you've left off. It's a new job. You would be starting all over again.
They did say, even my therapist told me never go back.
Yeah.
And I go, why is that? You got to move on and move forward.
That's right. And I'd already had another job. I wasn't losing out on anything. And that's the only reason why. Yeah, I couldn't take it. If they'd have done it on another night, I probably could have done it. But I won't take a night off from somewhere I'm already working and very happy for something that I wouldn't be too sure about. Yeah.
Right. Sydenham. That one you do in Sydenham on a Sunday. How do I get there?
It's finished. It's finished.
Oh.
Finished.
Finished.
Yeah, finished.
Oh, it's a shame.
Sorry about that, mate. Yeah, that finished in October. No, November. Hang on a minute. No, just before it finished, just before Christmas. Yeah, it went quiet. It went quiet, and I said to them, I said, look, it's gone a bit quiet. I said, quite honestly, I could do with another night off. If you want to knock it on the head, that's fine. And he said, Are you sure? And I said, yeah. He said, okay, make it next week then. Okay, fine. And that was that.
Do you still do karaoke at all? Like in
Central Station in King's Cross, Wharfdale Road.
Oh, King's Cross. Yes, I remember that bar. I don't know if I'm still barred yet.
Mondays and Fridays there.
Yes, that's I get a 78 bus, I think.
You're in Peckham, aren't you?
That's right. Peckham. I remember I got there from outside Peckham Library. I use the bus there. I think it was a 78 bus I used to get there.
Yes.
I remember. I'll find out.
I used to live there when it was until 1969, actually.
You lived in Peckham?
Yeah, commercial.
Oh, yeah, you said this a while back, yes.
Commercial
right.
Way, Droitwich House when I was a little boy.
I remember you talking about this when I was trying to get you a gig in Peckham about 5 or 6 years ago, and I failed miserably. You know, so I tried my hardest, you know. Yeah.
Never mind. Well, nice to talk to you, Blakey, all right?
Oh, brilliant. Nice to...
Glad you like the show as well, all right?
Anyway, that's great. Fantastic.
Cheerio, brilliant. Mr. Blakey.
All right, take care, mate.
Good luck to you. Bye-bye now. There we are. Blakey calling in from Peckham there. Do that like that and save. There we are. I do try and save all the people. Now, where were we? We haven't got to your messages yet, have you? You must be waiting for your messages to be read out. I'll come to those in a second. Let me just finish the story. So I was sitting there looking at my new phone, which looks exactly the same as the old one. You wouldn't know the difference. Apart from the inside, the processor is faster, and I'm hoping that things will be faster. For like when I've finished recording the show, I put it together. I'm hoping that's going to be a little bit faster as well in the upload and whatever. Then Ronnie came over with a strawberry milkshake, which was very nice. It was so thick, though. You know, you had trouble getting it up the straw. You had to suck really hard. Sucking and sucking and sucking, I said. Yes, on that thing. So we finished that, and then I think we went home. No, we didn't. We went into Marks and Spencer's. I know, I can't believe it. In Reading, a Marks and Spencer's and a John Lewis. Went in Marks and Spencer's in their food department. Because I quite like their mushroom and onion pies that they do with potato on the top. And I hadn't been in that Marks and Spencer's food place before. It's so much bigger than the one in Wokingham. It really is. It's massive. And it was a much larger selection of stuff in it. So I got that and some vegetables. Used the toilet in Marks and Spencer's. Came back out of there, down the escalator. Rushed through the ghastly people of Reading. And got back into the car and then came home. So it was a nice day. I popped back into my house, had a little bit of sleep. After that, his boyfriend was taking us out to dinner. We were all going out to dinner. So we went to Piccolino's, which is in... Oh, what area would it's classed? I think it's classed as Egham. Egham, Ascot, Sunningdale, sort of around that area. It's on the main road. And that was nice. And we go in there. It's a lovely place, Italian restaurant. And I had penne... Arabetta, I think that's what it's called, something like that. But I had to have the vegetarian because they do it with sausages. Sausages. They do it with sausages. So I asked it without the sausages. So I had that. But it was ever so cold in there. My God, it was cold. And it wasn't like they didn't have the heaters on. They've got like this extended area outside, which has got like plastic walls. And so when the wind blows, all this plastic comes in like that. And the drafts in there, I was blooming cold in there. They've got all the heatings on, you know, like the infrared heating. And there's a lot of heating on in there. But I was quite cold in there. And the service was okay. The boy doing us, he weren't that old. One of them, the three of them all together that served us, one was a little bit miserable. He didn't seem to smile a lot. He'd probably, mind you, it's the end of their shift. We didn't get this till 9:30. And then about 9:30, I said, can I have another Coke, please? Oh, I'm sorry, the bar's closed now. Huh? And, I don't complain. Oh, OK, then. And Ronnie says, that's a bit odd, isn't it? The bar closing when we're still sitting here. Anyway, 5 minutes later, he turns up with a bottle of Coke anyway. So that was OK. I don't understand. How can you close the bar when there's still people sitting there eating? Very strange. But we do like it in there. It's always very clean. And if it wasn't so cold in there, we would have probably stayed a bit longer. But you need to choose your seats carefully in there. And I'll tell you why. You can sit like I'm sitting here now on an upright seat, or they've got these sofas which are really low down. Now, I don't think Ronnie has a problem with it, but the seats are like down there and the tables. And I just have such trouble eating in such circumstances. I really do. I know you're trying to eat and you're just not comfortable, really. So if you're going in there, Piccolino's in Egham, I think it's classed as Egham, then make sure you sit at a table with chairs. And we came out of there, went back to Ronnie's house, watched a bit of telly. And what was it watched last night? Oh, it was good. It was about magicians. I think it was on Channel 5. It might have been a recording they were watching from their Sky Plus... Q thing that they've got in there. I haven't got anything like that. I've got no subscription television. So we're watching that, and it's about magicians' tricks that have gone wrong. Oh my God, you want to see some of them? People that get stuck in water. You know, like there was a milk churn. There was a milk churn, and this bloke goes in this milk churn, and you know, the water's right out, and you see his head going into the water, and they put the lid on and do four padlocks up. And he has to escape from it. Well, he doesn't. He doesn't. And all of a sudden, you can hear this splashing. And another bloke comes over and starts undoing the locks. He takes it and oh, it's awful. Awful. But it was a worse one than that. There was a worse one than that. This woman, she went in this, like, glass plastic tube, which was so high, you know, she got in there, and again, they put the lid on, put the padlocks on, and she's got to take off handcuffs and things. I know there's some of you that wear handcuffs, don't you? Don't want to know about that, thank you. She's got handcuffs, she takes those off, and then you see her struggling, and all of a sudden, she stops moving. And she's like that. She's like that. And again, a bloke rushes over, starts undoing this, and she's not moving. She's not even waving to the bloke. And then eventually they drag her out. Well, I mean, God's sake. And these people take risks, don't they? Awful. You imagine, like, they're drowning in something like that. And then there was another bloke in Norway, right? And he decides, now you know how cold it is there. So they've got this frozen lake. This frozen lake, and he cuts a hole in this frozen lake. I think then they padlock his arms and things like that. And then they drop him through this hole in the lake. And they're counting. Well, of course, he doesn't come back up again, does he? Oh, dear. And a diver has to go in and they can't find him because all the mud, when he jumped in, it disturbed all the dirt and the mud in the lake. So, of course, they can't see anything under there now. And eventually, the diver came, well, we can't find him. And eventually he came back out on his own. Awful. But he was in a state of panic. And of course, it's freezing cold water, like 4 degrees. These people are mad. But these magicians do anything, don't they? There were some very, very good looking young magicians on that, I tell you. So that was my day yesterday. That was my day yesterday and I had a lovely, lovely time. Thank you very much. Right, would you like me now to read some of your messages that I haven't read yet? I sometimes think, and our good friend Wendy has mentioned this a couple of times. She said that, oh, we've got a phone call coming through. Hello, Elaine in Israel. Hello, Elaine, how are you?
Hi, Chris. How are you?
How did your radio show go, darling? I was out, so I missed it.
Oh, that's okay. They're going to post a link on the radio station site.
Yes.
And I'll send it to you as soon as I get it. Oh but it was fabulous.
Please put the link on my wall. Is it, no disrespect, Elaine, but is it in English? Otherwise, I won't understand the squiggles.
Of course it's in English.
Because I can't understand.
Would I send you a link to a show in Hebrew?
Well, when I went to, a couple of years ago when I was in Israel, I went to the bus station in Tel Aviv. And I thought, you know, generally in another language, you can kind of work out where the buses are going and what. I had not. No way you could work that out for yourself. So I just went into the office and they told me which was the bus to Jerusalem, which is like, I think there's quite a few per hour, isn't there? It's quite an easy thing to do that, get a bus to Jerusalem from Tel Aviv.
Yes, and now you haven't taken the train yet to Jerusalem, have you?
No, that's up and running now. They were still building that when I went there. I remember as you were getting... Yeah, as we were going on that road, because it's built alongside the road, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes, and I remember seeing it as we were going along in the coach on the road. This railway was like, you know, high on like stilts, and it just stopped, you know, which is as far as they'd got. So they finished that off very quickly, didn't they?
Yeah, yes, it is very quick, and should be... And it's about an hour and a half ride, it's going to be—it's beautiful. Cuts through the mountains, and we'll go together when you get here.
That would be lovely. Yes.
Anyway, the show was incredible. It was so good.
Let's just tell people: Elaine hosted a Barry Manilow radio special. I think it was yesterday, wasn't it? Yesterday afternoon.
Yes, it was yesterday. Yes, yeah.
And that was on a radio station in I think a community radio station. Is that right?
Community
radio
station
in Israel. And she'd done that yesterday.
It was truly the best 2 hours I've spent in a very long time.
Yeah.
And it was amazing. I picked, you know, like everyone else can't smile without you and Cope Cabana and all the big hits. But I chose mostly album tracks.
Right.
Like my favorite album tracks, and they went over very well. The responses were fantastic. And
what tracks did you play? Can we know some of them?
Oh, I played If I Should Love Again, which is my favorite song.
If I Should Love Again.
I played the songs from 15 Minutes. I played Made It Through the Rain. I played This Can't Be Real with Olivia Newton-John. I went through like a list of album tracks that not everyone is familiar, like the civilians wouldn't be familiar with them.
Civilians.
Civilians, yeah, don't you know that term?
Did you have good feedback from the listeners?
Oh yes, I did actually. Yes, I did. It was so heartwarming, mostly from the overseas visitors.
Yes.
My Facebook feed was filled with wonderful messages. It was great.
Excellent.
And I interviewed his former co-producer, who produced like his first couple of albums in the early 70s. I had him live on the phone from Los Angeles.
Wow. Did you have a little thought in your brain that said to you, I wonder what would be the chances of Barry actually calling in? Did that ever go through your mind?
No. No.
I still hope he's going to turn up at one of my karaoke nights, Elaine.
You know what? Stranger things have happened, Chris.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You never know.
Oh, lovely. So you're going to put a link on my Facebook wall, aren't you?
Absolutely, it was wonderful, and I did everything. You know what? You gave me very good advice to do, like the beginning and the end and whatever.
Yeah.
And I made myself lists. I made like meticulous lists of what I was going to say, what I was going to do.
Yeah. Okay.
The song list, everything. As soon as I started, all the lists went out the window.
Yeah, that can happen. Yeah, yeah, that's okay.
I mean,
that doesn't matter.
Changed.
That doesn't matter because it was there for you to fall back on.
But it was fabulous. It was the best time ever.
Good. Oh, I'm so pleased you made a success of that, Elaine. Maybe a little regular show on that station. Would you like to do something like that?
Oh, if I was offered, I'd be very hard pressed to say no. But
why don't you ask?
Well, it's not up to me.
Come on, you want to do that. I can hear it in your voice. Doesn't have to be a Barry Manilow special over every day. You know, just general music.
No.
Go and ask them, Elaine. What you got to lose? What can they do? Say no. That's it. That's all that can go
well,
wrong. They say
I
no.
I don't know.
I know you want to do it. I can hear it in your voice. Do it.
Listen, I want a lot of things, Chris, that I'm not going to get.
Oh, bless. You're not saving up for one of those places on, is it Sinan's Hill or something like that? What is it?
I'm saving myself for the BBC so I can work with you.
Oh, gosh. I'm really pleased for you, Elaine. We look forward to listening to that if you put the link
Thank
on our
Thank you.
Wall,
I'm
right?
at work now, so I can't really talk long. I just wanted to tell you about the show, that it was wonderful.
That's all right, Elaine. Thanks very much for calling in, darling.
Yeah, you're welcome, dear. Have a very good day and love to all your listeners.
You too. Lots of love, Elaine. Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.
There we are, the lovely Elaine. Oh, she's got a phone call there in Israel, who often calls in there. Voiceover artists has put a little message on there. He says, time to celebrate your birthday by purchasing a new windscreen for the studio mic. The old one is starting to grow mushrooms. Well, here's the old one. There's nothing wrong with this. Nothing wrong with that at all. What's wrong with this old mic? You know, we don't buy things for the sake of it, dear. They've got to be not working. Another call coming in on a mobile. Hello, who's that?
Good morning, Chris Ridden, international DJ and superstar.
Good morning to Adam the Plumber.
But
Adam the Plumber.
I'm just phoning in as your personal trainer.
Yes.
To find out how the Slimming World diet is going. Because unfortunately, I've been trying to watch your show going down to Brighton today.
Yes.
And every 5 minutes, I'm getting annoying phone calls, which is cutting the live stream off.
You must put them on reject, dear. Well, I have to tell you, of course, it was my birthday celebrations yesterday. So we went out to dinner. So that hasn't really happened yet. Now, I have got your chocolate things here. I haven't eaten those yet. I noticed one of them's dark choc mint. Now, I won't eat this. Shall I bring that? Shall I put that back in the car for you?
What, the dark chocolate one?
The dark choc mint one. That's not really me, that one.
All right, okay, yep.
So
okay,
I can put that back in the car?
I shall bring you some other flavours to try. There are some other flavours.
Okay.
There is an orange one.
Orange I do, yes, orange
and
I do. How many calories in one of these, then? Let's have a look.
Salted caramel, I think it is.
All right, okay. I can't get the box open, dear. Oh, they're a bit small, dear. How many calories in one of these, then? Where's the glasses?
If you look on the front of the box here...
Oh, yes.
It says how many sins. I think it's 3 sins per bar, or 2 bars is part of your healthy extras.
Oh, it's 3 sins per bar. I was surprised, because as soon as you left the pub, because you didn't come Monday, were you all right Monday? I had a feeling your back was playing up.
Yeah, it was a little bit painful, and I took some...
I thought so, yeah.
...cocodamol, and basically it knocked me out for the night, so I wasn't able to go out.
So that's... Well, I mean, it's 293 in a bar. That's quite a lot, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But I was surprised as soon as you showed me that thing. And then when I got home Sunday night, wasn't it? Sunday night.
Yeah.
I typed in banana. Mm-hmm. Well, you can have as many of those as you want.
Yes, you
no
can.
No sins. Yep. Zero sins. So I thought I might change my whole life and become a monkey.
You never know. You could do, yes.
And just live on bananas. So now in the morning, with my bran flake, with my fruit and fibre bran, I now have a chopped up banana to make it even more. So it makes me eat less at lunchtime. So it has kind of started, but not properly yet.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you have one of the bars there with you now, do you?
I do, yeah, but I'm not going to eat it now because I'm not hungry. No
you're
point in eating.
You're not going to do a live test in front of the nation.
It's got to be a live one, hasn't it? So what we'll have to do is when I have a live afternoon show, when I do a live afternoon show at some point, I'll do it then. Yeah. It's a bit early for me to have that. And plus, I haven't been swimming yet.
And see if you spit it out across the room or whether you just sit there and divulge the entire box.
I have sampled stuff on air before, a long time ago now. I'll tell you who does that. A friend of mine, Tom Harris. Do you know Tom Harris?
I've heard the name, yes.
Tom Harris is doing eating sampling things at the moment on his little videos. Yes.
All right, yep.
Yeah.
Sounds interesting.
How's your back this morning? Because you've had a bad back, haven't you?
Yeah, I've got what's known as a prolapse disc.
Oh, right, yes.
So there's still some pain there, but I'm taking the medication to sort of ease the pain and until it sort of pops itself back into its right place. But I'm just being extra. I'm back at work. I've had to go back to work because I just cannot afford to be off because, of course, you only get statutory sick pay after a week of being off.
Well, what's that, about 25 quid or something ridiculous like that?
Something like that. And, of course, I've been off for a week, so I don't even get the statutory sick pay. Basically, I had to... it was either... and so I was running out of money, as it were, because the bills don't stop coming out. So I've had to go back to work.
Okay, and there's nothing they do for that? No, you just have to wait for it to slip back into place, do you?
Yeah, just have to wait now until it adjusts itself.
A little bit like a broken rib. Do you know if you break a rib, there's nothing they can do? You just have to wait for it to fix itself, don't you? Yeah.
I mean, Sean's an A&E nurse at the local hospital.
Right.
And, he sort of looked at it and I actually ended up in his A&E.
Right.
Because the back got so bad, I just couldn't do anything, and
yes.
I had to have a couple of tablets, some morphine, and a suppository, and then they literally stood on my back.
A suppository.
Yes, a suppository.
Dear. Was that a large one? Was it?
and then they literally.
Who put that in for you? Oh dear me! Did it have an applicator? Did it have an applicator?
Yes, I could tell you what the applicator is, but people might be eating their breakfast.
Well, this time of the morning, I should blooming well open. Oh, of course, we are global, aren't we? So
people are
waking up to this program. They are, darling. We're waking up in America.
Yes, exactly. But for what use of suppository you did? I might as well put it up the that's that old joke, isn't it? Many years ago, I used to be a dresser for Earl Grey when he first started. First started his shows, and I could more or less take the entire show off with all the impressions and everything because I've done it for so long. And that was one of the jokes that was in there. It was
And you have to be, you know, if you've got like a medicine cabinet full of stuff, you've got to be so careful with some of this stuff, dear. You know, I think it was my sister, actually. She once accidentally put on hair remover cream instead of pile cream. Oh, there was great pain, dear. It was red raw, apparently. Red raw.
Yes, I can imagine. Yes. Didn't you use toothpaste the other day for your...
stop that now, dear. Oh, this is so much better than talking about politics, isn't it? It really is.
Well, it's
like on LBC.
Sort of thing.
James O'Brien. James O'Brien's on there at the moment. Oh, he's such low, so left wing. It's unbelievable, dear.
Oh, God.
I mean, he's the sort of person that you would see walking through Reading. I mean, he really is.
Isn't
one
that
of those
what LBC stands for? Labour Broadcasting Company.
Because there's a lot of them on there who are not like that.
Oh,
no,
okay.
They're not. Not but he's definitely way on the left. There's a couple of people way on the right, you know. I'm kind of in the middle on the right, in centre right. I am. That's where I stand. Centre slight right, I would say.
Yes, you go to the right.
Slight right, not hard right. Slightly right, slightly right. There is a difference.
You go slightly to the right.
Yeah. But I believe, you know, everyone has their opinions, and you should respect everyone's opinions. You know, just because someone don't agree with you, it doesn't mean that you are evil and you must die, which is like a lot of people think now, as you can see.
Well, it's like all these, you know, as you said before, all these ones that go, well, I'm voting for, when it was the Brexit thing, I'm staying in Brexit, and if you don't agree with me, unfriend me.
Yeah, well, that old crap.
Go away.
Yeah, madness. Are you at work now?
I am. I've just pulled up in Brighton.
And what are you doing? What job are you doing today? You don't have to say where it is, obviously, but what job are you doing now?
I can say where it is. It's in Brighton, and I've got two jobs. I've got a what they call a Sani Flow, which is one of those macerating machines that...
Oh, I know what that does. Would you just explain to people what that is in a nice way, please? They don't know what a macerating machine is.
Okay, it's basically attaches to the back of the toilet pan. And when you flush the toilet, it grinds the contents of the toilet up.
Oh, God's sake, man!
And then it disappears down a very small tube. Well, unfortunately, that macerator has become very blocked.
Good luck with that. I mean, do you have some sort of mask in?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We're given all the proper what they call PPM, which is.
Have you ever undone a pipe and it splashes back in your face?
I've had that happen to me twice, and I literally got covered twice and had to go to hospital to make sure I was okay.
Awful!
I had a pump. There was at one station where the drainage is pumped away via pipe work, and the pipe we had a special fitting on it to divert the sewage while we were doing the works. And the pipe split, and I was stood right next to the pipe when it split.
Oh, my Lord.
So I got head to toe in that. And then many years ago, I was working in a government building in the city.
Yeah.
And we had a blockage in... It was a tower block. It was 10 floors high. We had a blockage in the line, and there was notices on every single door because they couldn't be locked. Do not enter. Do not use toilets. Do not do anything. Do not pass go. Do not collect £200.
Yeah.
And somebody decided to use a toilet. And because the access door was open where we were trying to clear the blockage, the air went in. And as they flushed, the two mixed and it released the blockage. And I got covered in 10 floors of you know what.
Oh, Adam, rather you than me, dear.
but I am when I do these sort of jobs, I am suitably attired. You know, I do have an all-in-one waterproof suit on, rubber gloves up to the elbows, and masks and eye protection.
I don't know if you heard the beginning of the show, but you know that problem I was having with the live camera, that it was jumping. What it seems to be is if I have the colour turned up too much.
Oh right, yep.
And I don't know why that is. Isn't that a strange thing, the colour? So I've fixed it by turning the colour down.
Right, okay.
But I don't know why. Don't know why. That's the thing.
I mean, I noticed with the new camera, because I'm calling you on my work phone and watching you on the iPhone as I'm talking to you.
Yes.
And I must say, the new camera, there's a lot more screen.
Yes, there is. Yeah, you can see a lot more. We can put more things up here now. Look, we can put more things on the wall.
You can spread your wares more across the back of the set.
I shall spread as widely as possible, Adam.
You'll be able to put up the other little clock now and things like that.
Yeah, I've got my Norfolk Island clock that I keep meaning to put up. Well, visited a while back. All right, my darling. Well, thanks for calling in.
Thank you, Chris, and have a wonderful day.
All right. Cheerio, Adam. Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now. Right, we won't be taking any more calls today, boys and girls, because it's a bit late now, to be honest. Hang on. Let me just type that in there. Okay, so won't be taking any more calls today. Thank you very much for those of you that called in. We've still got to do the birthdays yet. We've been chatting away for an hour now, and I haven't done any of your messages coming in. So let's just go through a few of those. I don't think I'm going to be... I don't know how many are here. Oh, there's tons of them, isn't there? Rachel, Elaine. I don't know if Elaine's still with us. Let me just get comfortable going. If Elaine's still with us, how about Rachel has suggested a programme, Israel Talks. So like this, but like a talk show coming from Israel. That might be something for you to try out there, Elaine. All right. Hello to Nancy. Alf is with us. Hello, Alfie. Hello to Tony Power. Says, Chris, I'm having a bacon sandwich, if you don't mind. Oh, those poor little pigs, Tony. You look up pig cruelty on YouTube and you'll find why you shouldn't be eating a bacon sandwich, my love. Hello, Tony. Nice to see you. Rachel said it's a new meaning to get in... Faced. Adam. Poor Adam. Imagine being covered in something like that. Hello to Kevin Webster. Blakey was with us as well. Hello, Blakey. Duke's with us this morning. Good morning, little Dukey. All right, sweetheart. Hello, Duke. Sharon Stones is there. Don't you do Camden anymore? No, Sharon. I only do Central Station in King's Cross now. I gave up the Camden one back in November last year. However, that is still going now. My friend Ben Parker does Golden Lion karaoke in Camden every Tuesday from, it's either 8 or 9. I think it's 9 o'clock. From 9 to 12, OK? That's when that's on. So that is still on, and Ben does it now, all right? Good morning to Alan Russell. Morning to Mark Corning. Morning, Mark. Morning to Ray Reynolds, who says, got my last mic stand from Denmark Street, Tin Pan Alley. Very reasonable. Wonder if it could be adapted for your camera. No, because the screw on the top's too big. Tried that already, but thank you very much for that, Ray. I do have a tripod, a proper, like, camera tripod. And I've been thinking, because we're now on, we're talking about Central Station, you may have noticed I'm on round tables there, and there's a gap. Now, it may be that I can put the tripod in that gap and use that. So we're going to try that. All right, Ray. Thank you, Ray. I don't want to miss anyone out, you see. Let me have a look. Tony, good morning, Tony John. Get Elvis Presley. What, you want me to sing Elvis Presley? Say one for the money. No, that's not it. Just a minute. Jailhouse Rock. Rock to da 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 da. I don't know the words. I don't know the words to the Elvis, Tony. Can you do Elvis? When are you going to turn up at my karaoke, Tony John? About time you came down there, all right? Good morning to Wayne Fairfield. Did you watch Moorside last night? What's your views? No, I didn't. But when I watched the telly this morning, because I watched the news when I get up, the very posh Victoria Derbyshire. Oh, good morning and welcome to the Victoria Derbyshire show every morning at 9 o'clock here on the BBC News Channel. Oh, she's like, I like her, Victoria Derbyshire. She went for a hard time last year. She had breast cancer and they filmed all the what she went through and all that business with the chemotherapy. And I can't remember if she had one removed or not, but it was all very... very personal and top marks to her for that. It was very good. She was talking us through from when she first was diagnosed with the breast cancer and she had the treatment. And I think they managed to get rid of it. Although, don't you have to go back a while after so many months or a year or weeks? I don't know. So she'd done all that last year. But she's very good, Victoria. But the very posh Victoria Derbyshire. I'd like to meet her for a cup of tea. She's nice. So she was on there. Wayne, the Moorside thing, yeah. So I was watching it, and then I saw an advert come up for Moorside. So I went on it, and of course I've missed the first one, which was last night. But I'll probably watch that on the BBC Play in the internet recorded thing, you know. oh, what's that called? The iPlayer. I'll probably watch that on the iPlayer, and I've set up the recording to do episode 2 next week. Thank you, Wayne, for reminding me on that. Alfie says, rainbow hair gives off and receives energy. What, just by putting little bits of string in it? Different colour. It'll all look very strange to me, Alfie. All right. Good morning to Andrew Robbins. Hello, sir. I hope you're well. He says, get the cat a coat. That's a good idea. Save on my heating bills, wouldn't it? Yes. Ah, Wendy says, we're talking about how many pounds is half a stone? It is 7 pounds. So thank you for that. Tim Pardington says, I had a Subway Mega Melt. Just £1.70 with the voucher from Metro. Very good. Oh, good morning to Danny Gibbs, who says, no, what about me? What's about you? I think that's, I can't get any more messages. I think that's as far down as it will allow me to scroll. Let me try. Yep, I can't get down any further. Oh, hang on, what's an arrow here? Hang on, what's this mean? No. Can I get any more down there? No, I'll have to wait for it to come up again. All right, so there we are. That's our little bit of a chat this morning, boys and girls. We only have one birthday today. Isn't that funny? You know, sometimes I can sit there and you've got about 10 birthdays going on. Today, just one. So happy birthday today to Corney Thompson. Corney Thompson. And there's a picture of the Disney castle. Now, let's have a look at you, Corney. Whereabouts are you? You're in California from Tampa, Florida. I love Florida. I totally love Florida. If offered a job in Florida, then I would probably go and do a little radio thing, karaoke thing there. That would be quite nice, wouldn't it? So please get your suits on and find me somewhere to work in Florida. Happy birthday to Corney Thompson. Here we go. Happy birthday, dear Corney in Florida. Happy birthday to you. All right, have a nice birthday, Corney. And that's it today. Thank you very much, boys and girls, for watching the show. We'll have another one very soon. And it's been very nice of you to join me. I'll see you again soon. Oh, tonight, nearly forgot. Tonight, it's Wednesday night. I'll be hosting the quiz night at the King's Head Theatre Bar. It's in Upper Street, Islington. Starts at 8:30, finishes at 10:30. That's every Wednesday, 8:30 to 10:30. So that's tonight. Four rounds, two lots of questions, a picture round and a music round. It's completely free to enter. Some people are coming over. Well, how much is it? It's free. Free. It doesn't cost you anything to enter. And you can walk out there with a £30 bar tab. I walk out there with much more than that, but you, you'll walk out there with a £30 bar tab. So please come and join us. It's all a bit of fun. You know me, I'm not a serious person, although I don't like, I get very upset with people that are cheating. Yes, we caught someone cheating there a number of weeks ago, and they're dead now. I'm afraid they're dead. I had to have them murdered in the middle of the street with all the cameras and everything. I called all the TV people. Please come and watch what happens if you cheat at one of my quizzes. And what it is, I found out what time they were about to leave. Okay, and I rung up the television authorities, and they all got down there. Be filming here at Smith. And I rung up a friend of mine who drives a bus, and I had them run over and killed. So please don't cheat at my quizzes. People get very, very upset. They weren't just killed, they were then chopped up into small pieces and placed into bins all around London. Yes, they never catch you. They never, never catch you. The only thing is, you never want to admit anything like that on the television. You really don't, darling. That's all today. Thank you very much, boys and girls. Have a lovely, lovely,